Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the second day of Recto VRso Festival and Conference Program. Yesterday, we had the pleasure to host Maurice Benayoun, Maxence Grugier, and Peggy Schoenege, who shared and discussed through their talks and during the debate the challenges of creating and promoting digital art at distance. And today's morning session will focus on the position of cultural institutions during the pandemic. This session is created and moderated by Ursula Gleisner, expert in virtual reality and consultant in strategy, marketing, and management of international XR projects. Before giving the floor to Ursula and our speakers, just a quick reminder, please keep your microphone off until the end of the lecture. You can click on a chair to sit. And in order to get the best view of the stage, use the screen zoom buttons on the top of your screen and remain seated during the conference. And feel free to use the public chat to react and ask questions at the end of the conference. Thank you very much. Welcome, Ursula.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Elhem. Good morning for the second day of Recto VRso. This morning session is entitled Hybrid Museums in a New Reality in Pandemic World. And we have a huge pleasure to welcome and to have four conferencers who would be great, great experts that I'll present you later on, that will give you the full landscape on the transformation that today the cultural institution face today. So we'll start with Roei Amit, who's into 5 minutes, into 2 minutes time, head of digital of the RMN Grand Palais, the Association of French National Museums, and general manager of Grand Palais Inertie. Roei will give a keynote on digital realities and how our art and museums are expanding beyond the real and virtual. After that, we have the pleasure to welcome Paul Chen, head of digital of the Palais of Versailles. Paul will give us for insights of his strategy of digital strategies at the Palais of Versailles. We'll continue with So Hyung Ko, who is the director of Art Center Nabi in South Korea. The Art Center Nabi actually for 20 years is already exploring the new man-machine age and exploring the exposition that are mixing data science, artificial intelligence, and art. And finally, we'll have the presentation of Valentino Catricala, who is the curator of the Soda Gallery Manchester and lecturer Manchester Metropolitan University, and who will give us his insights more from curator point of view about all the evolution of art and technology. And finally, we'll have in the end of this morning session, we'll have the discussion about all the transformations that the cultural institution they are facing today, how to transfer the art and exhibition in digital spaces, how to welcome public galleries and virtual scenographies. So welcome for the second day. And also I want to thank you very much because maybe most of the speakers and you public, it's the first time that you are in the virtual world. So thank you very much for this adventure and taking part in this adventure. So I want to right now welcome Roei. I give you the stage, please.
Hello, hello, good morning, everyone. I hope you can hear me. Thank you. Thank you, Ursula. Thank you, Recto VRso. Thank you for having me. Here I guess it will be good. Hope you can see and hear me all. I'm really, really happy to be here with you, especially after last night party. What does it mean actually being here with you? What does it mean? I've titled my presentation Digital Realities. I hope I can slide on to... No, this is not mine. Not my presentation. I will try to find this. Um, Are there guys up there in the right one? This is, of course, what happened when we are in digital worlds.
Yes, of course, it was always small surprises in the morning, especially for to welcome the day. This is normal. So we did it. So it's done. Okay, Roei, it's on the stage. You have got your presentation.
No problem. Yeah, I can find it now. So so I've titled my presentation Digital Realities, Expending Art and Museums Experience. And this is actually what we are doing right now. We are expanding our experience. And of course, you will be indulgent when we'll expanding it and making some perhaps virtual and avatar errors. So let's expand our reality. Perhaps before starting the presentation, I would like to share with you just several slides and images from our 2019 emotion experience with Wim Wenders. It was before the pandemic. And what we did, we projected large scale digital images at the heart of the Grand Palais Neuve. We explore cinema as a plastic art. We present, represent, and re-represent Wim Wenders' work in a completely new way. Public watched, walked, danced inside the work. It was a really an expanding the experience of art. See lots of people. Yeah, today it's almost hard to believe we can have more than 5,000 people at the same time. What I would like to propose this morning, when we speak about virtual, is that virtual and real are not a dichotomy. I would like to propose that when we speak about virtual, one shouldn't apprehend it as an absence of existence or as an opposition of a real. I guess you know that from its etymological origin in Latin, virtualis, coming actually from the Greek translation of Aristotle, virtual is a potential, possibility, possibilities. It's not opposed to reality. Why actually we can use the virtual to empower the way we are expanding our experience. So instead of speaking about real or virtual, let's speak more perhaps about 50 shades of reals, 50 shades of reality. Don't worry, I won't speak about this famous film that I guess everyone saw. I will give 50 examples. I will give only five examples, five study case where virtual is a potential of expanding the reality. So, a first example. First is our online noir et blanc, black and white exhibition visit. Prive of its opening in the physical gallery, it's a real victim of the COVID situation. So we propose to visit exactly the same space, but online, from wherever one is, can visit this exhibition. Some might call it a virtual visit. My sense, it's a real visit, because we are really visiting an exhibition. Of course, the experience is very different. When one is on its sofa surfing on her or his laptop or tablet, it's not like being actually in the gallery. Nevertheless, it's a real experience of this exhibition. You can do it either solo by our own or with a mediator that explained to us how it works. We even charge several euros for it. It's another effect of the pandemic when us cultural institutions should look for alternative source of finance. What we have observed since that this type of visit, this type of engagement, even paying, increase engagement. Visitors are coming twice and staying all together almost an hour. We've launched another one last week. So the black and white exhibition we launched a month ago, and we had already more than 2,000 visitors. Last week, another exhibition that for the moment is still closed. We really hope to open it physically one day, perhaps in May. But in the meantime, we've launched it online for this new type of a visit. It's Femme Peintre at Musée de Luxembourg, and you can visit it online, the same as Noir et Blanc. Another example when virtual expand the real is our upcoming, for next June, a VR discovery tour of six sculpture masterpieces. This time it's a VR headset that permits to have a very real experience of a non-physical imagined scenographic space. It invites to explore 3D sculptures from prehistoric to modern times. And once one put its headset on, it's like being there in this fantastic space we've created, surrounded by masterpieces of art. Surrounded, but in a physical space, is our Pompeii exhibition experience last summer in Paris. We had the luck to welcome over 200,000 visitors between the two COVID waves, a real luck, between July and October, and to share with them this new format of a location-based digital exhibition experience. Combining immersion, narration, and interaction, creating at the same time emotion and sharing knowledge about the history and the new archaeological discoveries, Pompeii exhibition is an example of our new format of the Grand Palais Immersif program. We are developing it exactly in the sense of expanding arts and cultural experience beyond the dichotomy of the real and the virtual. You can see people with masks, already pandemic time, but people were there. Another example to go beyond this opposition, what guided us when developing last December the augmented reality experience that everyone having an Instagram application can use. Playing, exploring, modeling one's environment, taking pictures, but also getting information about the gesture of reproducing the real. The sculpture as a reproduction, but also reproduction the sculpture as a mold, and then reproducing it as a 3D digital file. Virtual, once again, is a possibility of the real. Everyone can have it in his pocket or her pocket. This brings me to the last example of this expanding experience, announcing our augmented reality festival to be held physically, let's hope, at the Grand Palais Éphémère mid-June, Palais Augmenté. Creating a new generation of artists, Laurent Mouffet, Mélodie Mousset, Manuel Rosner, and some others. We are working also with students from the Gobelin and the Écale. together with our partner Fisheye, we shall propose a large-scale augmented reality artwork set in an immersive space, physically at the Champ de Mars. We are to explore again with this festival that virtual is not opposed to the real, but part of it. And if you ask me, I think it's not the end. Soon, new potentials and possibilities will open to us, perhaps directly inside our brains, to expand experience as art and culture always do. What we suggest that virtual enable the real. But before leaving you, I would like to share the last word and give it to Philip K. Dick. Told us that reality is that which, when you stop believing it, doesn't go away. Let's meditate on it and see you soon in this world or in a real one. Hope to see you soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Roei. You can applaud Roei by by F4 if you can clap. We'll have the pleasure to, Roei, please stay with us, because during the panel we'll go much more into the details concerning, because you are also general manager of Grand Palais Immersif. So we'll go much more in details and talk about this exposition. So thank you very much, Roei. So right now I want to welcome, maybe if you have some questions, we have like to take one or two questions. Can you write it down in the chat? Maybe one question if somebody has. I saw that somebody's typing. So this is the opportunity to ask right now. Okay, Jevika, I see that Sophie is typing. So let's, Sophie, do you have question? No. Okay, so Roei, I think that maybe after that we'll have much more question after the panel. So thank you very much. And we'll go deeply also in lots of experiences that you are talking about. So now Noir et Blanc, Pompeii, Pent Femme. And right now I want to welcome Yves Paul Chen. I hope that Paul Chen, please, I welcome you on the stage. Paul Chen is head of digital of the Palais of Versailles. Since 2015, he's been the head of digital at the Palace of Versailles and is involved in the design and the creation of innovative digital content suitable for all audiences. So Paul today will give us the conference about digital at Versailles for all audiences, and will present many content on numerous supports that the Palais de Versailles is addressed to the widest audience. Please welcome Paul. So Paul, the stage is for you.
Hello, good morning to all. Thank you, Ursula, for the introduction. I hope you can hear me well. It's a big pleasure to speak after Roei on this amazing project that the RMN Grand Palais is running. So I'll try to to show the best of what Versailles can do in digital for the next 10 minutes. I'll be happy to answer your questions afterwards. So, so I have to. Sorry for that. Just to put in full screen. Okay. So, just a few figures about digital in Versailles before the introduction. So we have like more than 50 million sessions per year on our different digital tools. Half of our users on websites are on mobile now. We have one mobile application on iOS and Android, both for smartphone and tablet, with the audio guide in now 12 languages. Since yesterday, we just added the Ukrainian language. We have almost 800 Facebook fans, almost 500,000 Twitter followers, soon to be 1 million on Instagram, 64,000 on YouTube, and we just launched a few months ago our little last social network where we are on is TikTok, with a big success and already millions of views on our TikTok account. So this is quite important, and I just want to those figures from the social networks and all the people who are in contact with digitally with the Palace of Versailles really increased last year. And I think 2020 was a year of disaster and pandemic for many things, but we could also say that it's a year, and I'd be happy to speak with Roy during the debate in 1 hour about that. It was also the year where the global audience, the general public, discovered that museums were active online with various propositions and offers, some free, some on a fee. So there are virtual reality that we proposed last year, augmented reality, virtual tours, virtual exhibition, live on social networks, a lot of interaction with our communities, especially on Instagram. We have some new tools on the mobile applications that you can listen to at home. We launch also podcasts and so on and so on. It's something like there's a big acceleration in digital usage for museums. So for VR, as it is the theme of this conference, we launched our first VR experience with the Orange Foundation in 2018. And it's called Experience Versailles. And I'll show you a short video. And it was the opportunity for user, and it is still the opportunity for user because it is available for free on Steam. So you can download it for free and use it on your own devices. The opportunity to be live, two great days of the Palace of Versailles. One is September 1st of 1666. The Siam Embassy paid a visit to Louis XIV after a big travel from, so Siam is roughly what is Thailand today. And another experience 60 years after, the U-Ball for the wedding of the Dauphin, the son of Louis XV. So maybe we can play the short video now. To present the experience. Screen, yes. Okay, so maybe we don't play the video. I will send you the link afterwards. Cannot play the video. So this was our first experience. After that, in 2020, we launched Versailles VR, The Palace is Yours, that time in partnership with Google Arts and Culture, with the long-term partners of the Palace of Versailles for almost 10 years now. And it is a totally different experience, also available for free on Steam, and also on HTC Vive on Oculus Rift. And it's an experience where you can discover the Palace of Versailles as of today. from anywhere. So the team of Google came many times in Versailles to shoot thousands of pictures to recreate in photogrammetry the Palace of Versailles. So the great apartment of the king, the great apartment of the queen, the Hall of Mirror, but also the Opera House that you can see now on screen, and also the Royal Chapel and the organ. But it's not only walking around and wandering around inside the palace, which is already amazing, but it's also a lot of mediation content and exclusive content. So there are a dedicated audio guide, audio content, music, obviously, but also you can select more than 100 artworks, objects, to move them in a 360 degree and enjoy them. So here the video would be amazing to have. Okay, so the video cannot play. So I hope you were able to view the video. Okay, and you had a short view of the experience. And this experience gives the opportunity to everyone for free, and this experience is available in French, English, but also in Chinese, to discover all those exclusive content. The interesting thing with this project is that it can be displayed in many different places. Well, we launched it in September 2019. We launched it with a high school where the students. Elise, I will reply to your question afterwards. I will we launch it with a high school that lives the experience before coming to the palace. And really, it was interesting for them to have both the virtual experience and the live real experience on site. And we could see with this that the two experiences are really complementary. And the virtual tour is really a good way to prepare your visit in Versailles. Versailles is a quite complex place, and it's important to understand as much as possible what was Versailles and how the palace evolved for the last 300 years. And this project can be displayed so in school, but also in hospital, in retirement home, in prisons, and for all those places, we have many programs in Versailles, some digital, some not digital. But it's important for us, Versailles is a welcoming place, and it's important for us to be able to show Versailles to everyone, including to those who cannot access Versailles. So on the VR for us is a tool for what you cannot see. So you can have a picture of the staircase of the ambassadors that is no more existing in Versailles. Unfortunately, it's a lovely staircase that we have recreated in the experience Versailles with orange. And for us, I mean, when you're coming to Versailles, going to see the real Versailles, as it exists, but to discover places that change. And Versailles, the palace you see when you're visiting Versailles now, is not the palace as it was in during the reign of Louis XIV. It changed a lot since. This escalator is a good example. But there are also other reasons for why you cannot see some places, because you are far away, because it's too costly for your class to come from far away to visit the Palace of Versailles, and so on. So for us, it's an accessibility tool. It's also a mean to see in better condition. For example, the organ of the Royal Chapel that you can see here is not open to the public because it's fragile, because there are a lot of concerts and repetition and rehearsals in the Royal Chapel, so you cannot visit it as much as you would like. So it's also a good opportunity to visit, discover the palace in better condition with no visitors and for as much time as you want. So just one question is why there is no more VR sport in museum. There are some, this is a picture of the Museum National d'Histoire Naturelle. And in Versailles, we were wondering, okay, maybe we should propose to our visitors a VR spot, but first it's costly. And when you're going to Versailles, you're going to see Versailles, not to have a helmet and to see a screen. So for us, it's something important. There's a lot to see in Versailles, and the priority is obviously for what you can see for real. And there's also a budget issue. It's very expensive. VR is expensive to produce, and VR is expensive to distribute. Even in Versailles, which is quite big, as you can, as you know, it's difficult to find a place that we could dedicate it on the long term to the VR, because VR takes room. I mean, for three or four VR spots, you would need maybe like 50 or 100 square meters. And it also requires staff. I mean, you, the audience, maybe like some professional of VR, so something, VR is something quite familiar for you, but it's not for everyone. And for VR, you still need a lot of staff, which is costly, as you know. And this is why most projects are heavily sponsored, and the main sponsors are HTC, obviously, Dell for computer, it could be Google Arts and Culture, and obviously the Orange Foundation, that that we thank together with the Google Arts and Culture in Versailles. In Versailles, we also launched last December, together with Elhem, with Roy, a dedicated filter on Instagram. And so it's quite interesting, because as the main issue with VR is equipment, like people that do not own their own device, VR helmets, but they do own a smartphone, and most of us are on Instagram and social networks. So the distribution of VR effects, of AR effects, it's much easier. And I think this is something that a museum should insist on. And it can give you a lot of content during your visit, but also at home. It is this versatility is quite interesting, I think. So VR and AR, is it a tech for everyone? Yes, I think, but we should be careful not to exclude anyone of this kind of experience. And this is why I think VR, but mostly AR, should bring those experiences to everyone and create links between cultural institution at large and the global audience. And okay, I think maybe there's a few questions I will reply to before. And thank you to everyone. So there was a question about what is Google Art and Culture. Google Art and Culture is a non-profit branch of Google, of Alphabet, and it's a big partner of cultural institutions. There are more than 2,000 partners now of Google Art and Culture. They do have a lab based in Paris, and they are proposing many tools for many tools for cultural institutions at large. Obviously, museums, but not only. It can be libraries. It can be a lot of science museums. Obviously, I just show you the link here. And as you can see, there's a lot of different partners all around the world. So it's quite an interesting initiative, and they do help museum and cultural institutions spread their content around the world, and especially useful as their tools are really good at localization, translating your content in many different languages.
VRso, thank you very much, Paul. VRso, second question from Stéphane.
Yes. Yes, from Stéphane. Faites-vous des visites payantes? That's a good question. And yes, we are not doing yet some virtual tours to pay for, that you can pay for. But we are really like considering this. As of today, all our virtual tours are free, and we have different kind of tools. We have the virtual tools and the virtual exhibition. I don't know if it's clear for everyone. The virtual tour is like a street view of an existing exhibition that we do have inside the palace. So this is the case for Versailles Revival, the last year exhibition, and it will be the case for Hyacinthe Rigaud, Le Portrait Soleil, the next exhibition that was due to open last November, and that will open when the museum reopens. So those are virtual tours. Virtual exhibition is more about creating an ex nihilo exhibition that does not exist or did not exist in Versailles, but just online. But on those tools, we put them on the Google Arts and Culture platform. And but we are also working with a curator, kind of scenography, I mean digital scenography, and they are made with the same seriousness as we do the existing exhibition live. So which kind of camera do we use? So we are working with providers. We are not doing the captures ourselves. There's maybe like at least two different technology. Like for the photogrammetry, it's like some kind of camera that are working with artificial intelligence afterwards, and those camera are like high def reflex camera that you can buy in the commerce, like your regular camera provider. For the virtual tools, it's like a 360 camera, so it's kind of different. It works on the pod and it's turning on itself, so you have to exit the room. And yes, is that, Stéphane, is that clear for you, what we're doing with our camera? Okay, yeah, you're welcome. And I can't see the question above.
It's Paul, maybe because we need to move on with the program. So
okay,
thank you very much.
Thank you.
No, it was fantastic.
Great to be with you, and I'd be happy to reply to your question later on.
Yeah, later on, you will have all the, after the panel, we'll have also the moment to ask questions. So thank you very much. And thank you very much, Paul, to presenting us your digital strategy. Let's applaud Paul if it's F4 button. Thank you very much, Paul. And
thank you.
And right now, it's the tour of Sohyeong Ro, who is the director of Art Center Nabi. Sohyeong, are you here? I'm not sure. Yes, Sohyeong.
I am here.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Hello. Yes, please come on the stage. So Sohyeong Ro, it's the director of Art Center Nabi in South Korea. As I stated at the beginning, Art Center Nabi for already 20 years has been exploring the new man-machine age and how technology has influenced, the digital has influenced on our lives. It's also Art Center Nabi is at the center of this new culture where artist sensibility is combined with the technological possibility to bring out the power of change and creativity. So today, So Yeong, please present your conference on the theme, The Age of Creator Has Come Finally. The stage is for you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ursula. And I'm very happy to be here. And I'm setting up a presentation right now. Okay, it's my first time to attend a conference like this. I'm sure many of you are like me. So I am both thrilled and very timid at the same time. yeah, wish me luck. Rather than initiating something new during this pandemic, we at the Nabi Art Center, we sat back and reflected on our past 20 years as a digital art center. Nabi started in the year 2000, when the optimism for the coming digital age was very high. We subsequently witnessed the emergence of Web 2.0 by Google, proliferation of SNSs, smartphone, and lately blockchain technology, shaping and changing not only the digital sphere, but our everyday sphere, our very own lives. Throughout the evolution of the digital technology of the past 20 years, I noticed some significant trends that have not only persisted, but evolved further with the advancement of the technology. Reason to suspect that these trends or inclinations have something to do with our fundamental desires or needs in us. So I'm going to mainly talk about those. So these are the trends that I'm going to walk you through, illustrating with Nabi's past projects. First, increasing web space or servers. We, humanity as a whole, are experimenting and playing how to mold time and space as we like. We can be at times at a loss about what to do or how to proceed with this giga expanding spaces. Giga expanding spaces, but don't worry, these platform giants are here. But apart from those, there have been efforts by artists and technologists to use the web to create different realities, spaces and times. Anyway, here I am. So here is our very first project in the year 2000, 20 years ago. So you're looking at a 3D space, a proto metaverse, so to speak. Here, we invited artists, technologists, and curators from all over the world, we asked them to take avatars of insects, like flies, bees, and worms, etc. And as insects, we carried out very animated conversations about the state of the world. So the intent was to look and to experience the world as, from the perspective of insects rather than humans. Here is another example of utilizing web's creative potential. The artist asked the users to draw their own perception of time using the artist's homemade version of Photoshop. Interesting drawings from the users were collected and displayed on the web for everyone to see and to appreciate. Okay, second trend. The first was the increasing web spaces. The second one, is a real-time communication. With the introduction of the network technology, connectivity became another essential element of life, like water and air. There was a spur of interest in real-time communication or synchronous communication at that time. We did a network performance with artists in Japan, but the latency at that time was 2 to 3 seconds and felt like forever. It was as if we were enacting a whole different kind of performances. But of course, the technology improved. This is 2010, and we were able to carry out probably the world's first telematic art dinner. We did this banquet interactive with our partners Saint Desar, Angyang Lebeng. We featured 3D screens, music and dance, as well as gastronomic sensations. So we asked our respective chefs in France and Korea work on the same ingredients. At that time was sea bass. Of course, we have a great predecessor, Nam June Park. In 1984, he envisioned a world that is connected seamlessly and becomes a whole through network technology. At that time, it was satellites. Only people, he contends, with clear conscience, like artists, can enter this seamless whole. And that was Peck's utopia. Number three, real and virtual interaction. Although the previous speaker, Romain, said there was no dichotomy as real and virtual. But you know what I'm talking about. What's virtual meaning? Something that is that appears with the aid of computer communication technologies. Okay, here. Here is the fun part, which regrettably we did not explore and exploit it enough. The interaction between the real and the virtual is always enchanting, a source of much creative application as well. But the few times we enacted it, it became very wild. So this one, will you run around the city tagging your opponents by taking photos of them? So if you take a photo with using your mobile phone, your opponent gets the message you're out. So it was in 2005. That was when the camera was first attached to mobile phones. Or this one. So here we collected artists and designers from a then very famous SNS service called SciWorld Zine. It was a collection of SNS services. And then here we had a virtual exhibition, but also at the same time we opened an real party, offline party, mirroring the online exhibition. So the same artists and designers came and decorated the offline spaces with the same similar designs and artworks. Another one. So you can, 2010, you can walk around the city of Seoul, or here in this case, Incheon. And then if you point at a monument, you can see the AR or mixed reality versions made by various artists. Okay, number four, everybody as artist. Another trend this digital technology has brought us is that more and more people participate in making something, playing with technology. From maker movement to YouTubers and now TikTokers, people are not shy of creating works, contents, arts, or whatever in DIY style. These self-styled artists may be the fulfillment of what Joseph Beuys once dreamt, everybody as an artist. Artists also depend less on the traditional art institutions like us and also in art market in order to survive. Over here, our seminal exhibition is called Lay Artist. We were able to invite, we invited over 1,000 artists, and they were all very happy. They were very happy because they were called as artists, and they were also noticed and appreciated by the public. Last but not least, blockchain. Blockchain technology is significant because it provides ownership over digital contents. And what a good news. Finally, for digital artists, their moment has come. to create art and also make a living out of it. So put all these things together, what do we see on the horizon? Well, I see NFT-based metaverses, art galleries, where art galleries initiated exist not only by art institutions, but by anybody who is willing to be a creator, or semi-creator, or supporter, or just fans of creators. We, in 2018, we experimented also, of course, with this blockchain technology. And at the time, Amy Kataria, he didn't know what to do with his created work with blockchain technology. Now he can sell his work on NFT chain. Now, this is what we are looking at. So there are already some pioneers, and you, all of you here probably heard about Beeple, and B20 Museum is entirely based on Beeple's artworks. And it does not take too much imagination or intelligence to know that the next significant art movement will be in these spaces, further advancing the five trends. Well, some people question, should we call this art? But I say, why not? Thank you very much. I will say.
Thank you very much, Sohra. It was really very interesting to see the evolution of expositions of technology or as a way to express. And to finish with new spaces like B20 Museums. So have you got question to, so let's applaud with F4 for the great intervention of Oroxion.
Thank you.
Have you got questions, maybe one question to Sohyun? Okay, there is one question, Sohyanka, from Victoire Chedry. So do you think these virtual places will be a great next movement?
Well, okay. It depends. It's really up to us to make it.
Okay, I think that Sohyanka will come back. So I think anyway, we'll ask this question after the panel as well for during this 10 minutes space. So right now I want to welcome Valentino Catricala. Valentino, are you here? Yes. So welcome on the stage. Valentino is a curator of the Soda Manchester Gallery Manchester and lecturer at Manchester Metropolitan University. He's a really passionate curator of technology and art. He's also the director of the art section of the Maker Fair, the European edition. It's the biggest fair on the creativity and innovation in Europe, and he's also the art consultant at Paris Sony's Heath Lab. And this year, Valentino, you published the book, The Artist as Inventor. So I give you, let's welcome Valentino, and the title of your conference is The Art as Inventor, Making Innovation Through Art. Welcome.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you perfectly.
Okay, very well. Because you know, it's a very new way to do talks, actually. So it's a very interesting experience. So thank you for the invitation first, and thank you for the introduction. And I'm happy to be here. And what I would like to do now is just a quick view of how arts can help actually innovation in society, even beyond the virtual reality. Of course, virtual reality is a very important part of this, but actually I will show you some example of even beyond virtual reality, art innovation in more general way. And I think that this could be important not only to look at us and our past as well, but especially now that there is a very big need of a new future, let's say, you know, in what the situation we are living, could be a good way to rethink the role of the artist into the society. And I think that this could be even important for also the future, actually. And Okay. So we usually, we're used to hear and listen, this kind of sentence, no? That today we are living a complex society, that new media are changing everything, and the way in which we talk, the way in which we communicate and behave, etc. And this is pretty true, but in my opinion, this is this kind of sentence hide, not very good, let's say, vision, that is always technologies that lead society and also lead the role of the practice of artists. Usually artists are relegated to, a secondary role, a passive role, not that artists use technology only once the technology has been created by the market, today we are talking of the prefix post has came back again, and as a marker, that if you say post, it means that there is a pre also, and also we're living in a post cinema society, we are living in a post media society, and today we are always in this post. But all these visions are, as I said, this vision that is always technologies that lead, the technology development, and also, we have a kind of a mystery, which is the market which create technology. We don't know where, we don't know why, but the market create technology, and after that, society, people, user, and then artists as well can finally use this. This technology, and so the technology development is always driven by the market. This is our vision actually, and what is I would like to flip this point of view and see how the artist can be not only a passive user of technology and creating content for contemporary artwork, but it could be also a new trigger for innovation and society. And through the concept of media art, we can call it in many different ways, new media art, digital art, media art, but actually the matter is that, as Oliver Graus said, that media are the kind of form that use technologies that fundamentally are changing our society, So let's see some example. Now, this is if we go back in the history, we see how Michael Neimark in the 1970 he created with the Lippard. Lippard was a very important engineer. He created the first interactive map of a city. The Aspen movie map, we are in the 1978 more or less, which is exactly the anticipating a social use of a technology, in this case Google Street View, but the important thing is to say that for Michael Neimark, the important thing wasn't to create an application or a technology for to be sold somewhere, for society. He wanted just to create something for his own vision of or artistic vision, but in this finding and in looking for the epiphany of the vision of the works, the artist experimenting with technology creates also innovation, and this is quite exemplary. An artist into a scientific labs in the 70s brings an idea that changed the way in which we look at orientation into the world, anticipating for 40 years the a social use of a technology. And at the same time, so we can go back in the history with one of the first example of live cinema or live experience. Now, Thomas Wilfred created the Clavilux for a live experience, of images, which was at that time was only, there was only the only way to experience moving image was through cinema, through a recording. In this way, you have live cinema. So a live experience, which is something that today we are very used to have, every concert today are surrounded by images and mixed by images and and sound, you know. And Thomas Wilfred also created a kind of homemade clavilux in the 30s, which is quite impressive if you think of our computer today. And we can jump further to the into the history and goes to Toisho Iwai, the first tenorion, which was a device for create a personal music, you know, digital music, anticipating what is today the launchpad, you know. And the example are many, many are part of this book that Ursula was mentioning, which was the artist as inventors, the artist as inventor, you know. And you can find there are many other examples also with virtual reality. So the matter is that if you look at the map that we saw before through this this example, so we see that it's not true that only the market creates technology and create innovation, but we can put the artists to the top of this map and see how the artists are the trigger of a new idea of innovation, or could be a trigger of a new idea of innovation, and have a direct impact into society. So artists are not anymore, are not only, especially the one who's used technology, of course, are not only someone who creates content for the contemporary artwork, you know, something blocked and closed there, which is very important. Again, from a curator, curatorial field, so I'm very close to that kind of field, but artists can be also a trigger for society, can be also that envision new future for society, experimenting technology and giving a new idea of sustainable and ethical idea of innovation, which is something that we need today. We need today, especially for rethinking, not only to rethink our society, but to make and to create the society of the future, you know. And and this is what we would like to do with Soda Gallery, which is where I'm working now in Manchester, which is a new building. It's not ready yet. It's going to be ready in September, October, and it is a school and a gallery. You know, it is part of a big financement by the UK government, you know. And what we would like to do is create not only a gallery in conventional way, of course we're going to do exhibition or whatever, but create a real dynamic production center, you know, connecting and making this connection between the innovation world and the arts world, you know, in this way making, you know, finding a new role of the artist into society and finding a new role of curator and the cultural institution in mediating between different fields, which is not only, you know, looking at an exhibition, which is very important, but it's also to create the society of the future. So thank you. I think that I use my time. I think that I've been I'm perfect in time. What do you think, Ursula?
Thank you very much, Valentino. So for this panorama of artists who are already the first innovators and experimenters, have you got some question to Valentino? Let's applaud Valentino F4 for his presentation. Yeah, bravo.
Thank you.
You have a question from Elisa Asport. Are you in connection with industries in Manchester?
This is a good question. I'm getting into connection with the company in Manchester. Actually, what I did is mostly with the Maker Fair, and I was directing the Media Art Festival at Maxi Museum. We did many projects with companies, with Epson, Microsoft, and Samsung as well. And we did this match in between our artists creating new content. With the Epson project was basically with augmented reality, the new augmented reality glasses of Epson, and three artists created three advanced content for augmented reality Epson glasses. And I mean, the company was very happy about that, and we were very happy. And now we are getting in touch with companies, and there is also, you know, an office in Soda for this. Yes, we're getting to.
Okay, have you got another question? We can take one more question if you have. I see that somebody typing. And we'll also go further because it's also the concept of Soda Gallery. It's very interesting about also producing, not only exhibiting, but also producing the exhibitions and working with different artists and tools. So we'll go into the. Okay, we have the question from Victoire Chaudry. The artist would thus be brought to the initiator of the new technological creation of tomorrow.
I mean, it's not only a matter of making technology, because the interest is of artists is not in making technologies. It is making technology, but not to sell the technology. I mean, the end of the artist is not to sell a technology or to create an app to sell, you know. But it's always for the artist following the epiphany of the work, you know. So find the right way, the right tools, the right media to create his own work, you know, and following the vision, you know, the epiphany of the work. But in this process, in this apparently linear process, that could be some outputs that can be used for innovation. So in this way, you know, and that outputs, and if we can use that outputs, and if innovation work use that. Those outputs for create a new idea of innovation, they can create also new technology and new content as well, you know, new ethical content as well for new technology. Because one of the big projects, especially with virtual reality, is that, which is the history of part of the history of technology, is that we create hardware, but we don't have content. I mean, it's not a matter of Recto VRso. Recto VRso wants to do this, you know, to find also new content for virtual reality, you know. So, and also new content and artists can help also to create new ethical content, sustainable content for rethinking of society and ourselves as well.
Okay, thank you very much, Valentino. Let's applaud Valentino with F4, please.
Thank you. Anybody wants to get in touch with me, Ursula is my contact. I don't know if I have to share my contact, Ursula. I mean, just or you.
Of course, you can share your contact. You can type it also in the public chat, and this is the same for all our speakers. The idea is to be in contact and to exchange and also to do networking, like in all festivals. And Valentino, don't go away. I want to welcome, please, Roei, Valentino, Paul, Soryung. Can you join me on the stage for half an hour, 45 minutes panel about art? So please, let's have a seat maybe here. Yeah, if you can see. Do you have everybody? Yeah, so I see there's Roei, Valentino, and Paul. Paul, is it Paul?
Yes. I'm on your left.
Okay, okay. yeah. Okay, hello, Paul. So right now, I want to go deeper with you concerning the subject about the transformation of cultural institutions. And I want to start this panel with the facts. Today we have a pandemic, most of museums and cultural institutions are closed. If they are open, there's very limited number of visitors. But I want to start from the very positive thing. What is actually the positive impact of COVID on your institution? So if I can ask maybe to start with Paul, if you can start. What is the positive impact?
Thank you, Ursula. Hello again to all. The COVID impact on the Place of Versailles is huge, as we were closed we've been closed for almost 6 months now, plus the first lockdown last year where we were closed for almost 3 months. So the first impact is that we are not able to welcome visitors inside the estate of Versailles, the garden or the palace. The park is now open, fortunately, but the palace is not. So this is the first impact, and the first consequence of this is the impact on the ticketing, because the ticketing is the main resource for the Palace of Versailles. And it's money that does not pour in to maintain and do work. So hopefully we have sponsors on the French state that is still supporting us, and we thank them. So this is a big impact, but the negative impact. But as I said in my presentation, there was a big acceleration in cultural digital content last year for the past Versailles, but not only. And I think one of the reasons we gained so many followers in our social accounts and in our virtual tours, it's also because people they really discovered last year that cultural digital was something important and big. And I think in France, we have quite a good expertise on this.
Yeah, thank you very much. So this was positive impact. So that you have like much more people who come through the online media to visit and to follow Palais of Versailles. And Roei, the same question. What is for you the positive impact? Because it's the RMN, the Association of French National Museums, it's 17 museums actually, represent 17 museums in France. So what are the positive effects actually of the COVID?
Yeah, positive. So as said, Paul, the first are very negative. The pandemic is a negative situation. We have lots of, everything is closed. Some of our exhibition and show, we couldn't even open them. And we have lots of people in an unemployment situation and loss of revenues. However, we find ourselves in this resilient, a very concept that became very in vogue the last time, resilient in the sense where first we need to maintain relations in the institution as a body of collaborators that are working together, even though we are not physically, maintaining relations with the public, with our different type of publics, and for it, digital was and is a very important vector. And third, find ways to develop our new type of revenue streams. So this type of situation really obliged us to look into these three aspects, and I think, of course, the coming out of the crisis won't be the same as getting in.
Okay, thank you very much, Roei. And it's true that it's collaboration. It's great to see the collaboration and between the cultural institution to come through this situation. I don't know, Sor Jung, Valentino, do you want to add something about the positive effects of maybe Sor Jung, have you got the positive effects of this pandemic?
Yeah. So yeah, I mean, as it has been said, you know, there, of course, I mean, difficult to say positive, you know, to use this word, but rather than positive, I would say what the pandemic has taught us, you know, what is teaching us. And I think that, I mean, pandemic has taught something important as well. I mean, because the pandemic has been a very big digital lab somehow, you know. I mean, in the pandemic, we have done a jump that we haven't been able to do in 20 years, you know. I mean, the use of the digital before the pandemic was completely, not completely, but was different from now, you know. Even if you look at, for instance, at online exhibition, you know, if you look at online exhibition in the beginning of the pandemic, they were very simple, you know, just some images and videos. And now, I mean, we have very easily, we can do virtual reality, virtual room, you know, look at the talks. And this is an example, you know, this talk would have been completely unthinkable before the pandemic. So I think that what we're teaching us, and at the same time, what is the lesson for the future, again, the future, you know, for after the pandemic. I think that the future is going to be hybrid, and cultural institutions must learn that, you know, also the digital will be more improved than before, you know. For instance, the website before were mostly some window for information for the exhibition. Now, in the future, we have to take into consideration the lesson and improve also the digital project. But at the same time, another lesson of the pandemic is that we can't endure anymore of being of the virtual world as well. And now we need physical as well. So this is another big lesson. I mean, we need physical exhibition as well. I saw an exhibition in person like 2 weeks ago. It was an incredible experience for me, you know. So I think that the future is going to be hybrid, and we have to think very well of how to lead this future in this direction.
Thank you, Valentino. It's true that it's a huge joy to go also to physical spaces. And so Yeong, because in Art Center Nabi, I think in South Korea you are open. So, mm-hmm. But what did you learn from this period? How it's going on for you during this time?
Yes, this COVID, although it's very unfortunate for many people, is opening up a great opportunity for digital artists. Digital artists so far for decades had a bit of a hard time because they could not sell their arts. But now with the opening up and this also pouring of funds into this web and spaces and new metaverses, there is increasing demand for something digital, some digital creativity. So it's a good opportunity for digital artists.
Okay, thank you very much. So the second question is, let's go more to the production and challenges of production of this new kind of experiences, because once again, we are going into the era of producing multi-platform experiences. And so what are the challenges for this production? I will maybe start from the poll, because Paul, when you were explaining the reasons and also the challenges of producing Versailles VR, the palace is yours, you mentioned about that it's very expensive, that it's about also to the necessity of knowing well the places, of having also strategy. Can you start with this? What was for you the challenges of producing this kind of new experiences?
Yes, thank you, Ursula. I think there are many challenges because when you are recreating, you have to recreate everything, especially in Versailles. You have to recreate the rooms, the walls, the decors, the ceilings. So recreation is quite difficult. This is why we prefer to do some photogrammetry or equivalent like laser grammetry. Technologies, but this is expensive, and because it's very costly to produce, but also costly to distribute. As today, and I don't think it will happen soon, helmet VR set are not a mass media device, such as a smartphone, for example. So, I think it's interesting to have virtual mixed exhibition such as Pompeii. Roy will speak better of this than me. But for us in Versailles, we do have a fully digital exhibition that we propose not in Versailles. This is virtually Versailles. It is now in Shanghai, China. It has been in Singapore before, and it will tour in 7 more cities in China. On there, you can discover Versailles with digital tools, including VR, including AR with a bike, and running your bike, and you have some screens showing you the gardens around. I think for us, VR is more out of Versailles. You discover Versailles from elsewhere, either an hospital in France or a mall in China where we propose a virtual Versailles, for example.
Okay, and so I come back. Thank you very much, Paul. And I come back to Roei, because once again, Roei, you are right. Also, the general manager of new initiative. It's Grand Palais Immersif, and there is really focusing on producing this kind of new experiences. Can you tell us what are the challenges while producing this new exhibitions?
Yeah, I just before speaking about it, I just want to precise that we are talking about different type of formats. What digital offer us is a large variety of formats of different type of experience. And each one of them, of these formats, is having different type of usages, different type of public, and of course, different ways of mode of production. It's different to produce a VR experience, an online exhibition visit, or an on-site large-scale digital experience, as was mentioned earlier on, as Pompeii. The challenges, of course, are diverse and multiply, especially when we speak about this type of big production. Exhibition like this needs first effort from tutorial point of view, content-wise, and then all the type of different multimedia scenography interfaces that going into it. So by producing this type of exhibition, our strategy was to dedicate it in a branch that will specialize in this type of production, to be able to gather the necessary funds for it, then to exploit it correctly, and to make it exportable, itinerant elsewhere. This is why we started earlier with other types of proof of concept of this type of format. And Pompeii last summer was once again a large scale experience. We are aiming to be able to produce this type of exhibition on a regular basis from the beginning of next year.
Okay, thank you. So there's a lot of challenges. So first one is really to choose the good format and technology. So can you give us maybe, it's the question to everybody, how you choose the technology accordingly to the exhibition? How do you do this choice? How you choose the good technology? For example, if you have exhibition, you are planning to introduce the new exhibition. How you choose the technology that you want to use? VR, AR, etc.
You want me to take it, or in our case, we look for choosing the technology or the type, different type of devices, interfaces. We try to think and to apprehend the general experience. General experience for the public, of course, related to the content we would like to share with it. So once we've done this, what we've learned that in on-site experience, it's really good to hybrid, how say that mixed, to join together different types of technology and formats in order to create a global diverse experience. So in this case of Pompeii, for example, we had a large scale projection, we had like interactive screens, we had a VR room. So we actually articulate different types in order to give, let's say, an exhaustive experience.
Okay, thank you. And maybe so Yeong also the same question. How do you choose technology? Because for 20 years, you are doing exhibition mixing data science, artificial intelligence. How do you choose the technology appropriate for your exhibition?
So far we have the kind of content, what kind of content comes first. And then next will be how do we, what kind of audience we are catering to. That will be the second question. And the third is how to implement it. So first, the content, the audience, and the know-how, whether it's feasible or is it too difficult technologically or financially.
Okay, thank you very much. And the next question is actually you are all co-producing because the next feature is actually that Paul, you told that you are doing this also your exhibition with different sponsors. Roy, also you did Pompeii, also it was co-production. I think also Valentino, I saw that you want to be also production gallery and production. So this is really like a new trend to co-produce the exhibitions, the idea to co-produce the exhibition.
I think that in the future, the networking will be more important, and also, you know, to share a project is gonna be more important, because we institution are, you know, have a budget problems, and there's gonna, and so we have to unite, let's say, you know, create joint project as well, and so in producing as well. So it's not only a matter of exhibiting anymore, but you know, producing, it's easy to say, it's less easy to do, you know, because it's not only a matter of money, it's a matter of, you know, making the right organization, etc. So you have also to have a knowledge, you know, to produce, because it's different to exhibit. I am in a quite privileged, let's say, situation, because you know, now I'm creating a gallery that doesn't exist yet, you know, but the opening exhibition will be on February 2022. So I haven't faced with Soda so far problem for closure or, you know, something similar, you know. But I faced with the Maker Faire, because the last edition, you know, the Rome Maker Faire usually has more than 100,000 people in 3 days. So it was a problem, and maybe it's going to be a problem even this year. So I was starting to organize a physical exhibition, and then I have to migrate on online. Again, what I did is mostly to create, like, let's say, site-specific project, and then we produce project for the online platform. You know, of course, we put some videos as well, but there were more than 30 artists, and they, almost all of them, created a project for the Maker Faire. So we produce, you know, so we didn't have shipping costs, you know, the physical costs. And then we were able to ask two artists to produce a new work for us, you know, and it was quite interesting because we follow all the organization. Was a very, I must say, this has been quite successful, I must say, you know, as experimental project. So, yes, I think that, we in the future, this kind of process is going to be, more developed.
And thank you very much, Valentino. And what about Roy? Because in Grand Palais Immersif, the exhibition that you will be producing, it will be co-productions, or you will be producing and curating the exhibition?
The co-producing system is very important for both say editorial and economical aspects of a project. For the editorial, because we meet and encounter and exchange with other institution or structure that share the same will to develop a subject. And at the same time, we give ourselves more margins, economic and finance-wise speaking. Producing this type of formats is expensive. So in order to find the funds, in order to share the risk, we think and we practice this type of co-producing management in order to be able to do the project.
Okay, and also the question about natural question about monetization. Paul, you told that you are not charging for the VR exhibition. Roy, you told that you are taking some part of ticketing. You have ticketing. So, what are the new ways actually of monetization of the new forms of exhibitions, who are very very cost expensive actually to produce? How you are doing it? You will charge the public? How you want to do it? It's an open question. Same as well.
Thank you, Ursula. Yes, there are different things. The Virtually Versailles exhibition in Shanghai is not free. It's something on site. It's in a mall, a commercial mall in Shanghai. So you have to pay to enter the exhibition. This is kind of a global partnership with a sponsor on the mall. What we do propose inside the Palace of Versailles, one ticket, and when you get inside the Palace of Versailles, whether you from a gratuity or you pay your ticket, whatever is inside the palace is free. And when for the Experience Versailles in 2018, for 1 month during the exhibition Les Visiteurs de Versailles, we have the VR experience for free for anyone who would pop up and say, okay, I want to try this in French or in English. And on the real exhibitions, they are quite costly too, obviously. So sometimes we forget this, but it's quite costly. What we do work on is to have a fee for the virtual exhibition, such as like in the RMN, like the exhibition, the photo exhibition that Roy presented earlier. And for this, today it's free, but can imagine that in the near future, it will not be free anymore. And we would charge somewhere between maybe 5 or 10 euros to access the exhibition. This is something, and we are also planning some guided tours, not free, with a professional guided tours in French or in English, for example, or maybe in other languages too.
Okay, thank you, Paul. And I don't know, Roy or Valentino, and so do you want to add about this new ways about monetization?
Yeah, about monetization, this is a good question, because for sure, I mean, the virtual world has improved, you know, a lot. Also the monetization, you know, the budget are growing, and also, you know, I spoke with some virtual reality companies, and they told me that, you know, they have improved the funding, the work, you know, I mean, they're growing a lot, you know. So the real matter is when we will return in a, let's say, a normal situation. What is going to happen when we'll start to travel again? I mean, I think that we won't travel as much as we used to do, and when we will start to go in physical places, and then we're less in front of our computer. So this is it's an open question. I really don't know how to reply to this.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I want to maybe right now to move to the public, actually. Who is the public, because you have experience with online exhibition. So who is the public? How did the public experience this online new type of virtual exhibitions? Can you give us some, you already gave some statistics in your presentation, but can you tell us more about their experience? And if you two, who wants to, I don't know, maybe Roei, if you can give us some feedbacks.
Yeah, we have a lot of feedbacks because each type of experience we are proposing, we are doing a public research and input to analyze how it was received. For example, the online visit for our last exhibition that, as we mentioned, we are actually selling it. We find that people stay a long time, almost as the time of visiting the physical exhibition. But some of the people find the navigation too complicated. We see that the link between our general public, those who comes physically to the galleries, and those who and to whom we are communicating the firsthand this type of experience, and we see that they are less inclined to do this type of visit. This is why we find more newcomers for the online exhibition. Mainly on social networks. This is like first return that we have on the online exhibition. For the physical exhibition, Immersive as Pompeii, we had lots of different type of feedbacks. It was perceived as a real family event. Who went came. With kids, with parents, the emotional parts were very well received, as well as the different type of proposition inside the exhibition. Some of our regular visitors find it somewhat short, in related to, let's say, habitual artifacts exhibition. So this is types of returns we have that we are analyzing, and of course improving ourselves for the next ones.
Okay, thank you very much. And Paul, can you give us some feedbacks about as well your audience?
Yes, there is different type of audience. The audience of Virtually Versailles is quite enthusiastic, with several thousand of visitors per day since the opening in early March. And the audience, I would say that the maturity is not here yet for the audience of virtual tours. I think the audience is more keen to watch those tours. Because they cannot access the Palace of Versailles, either because it is closed or because the Palace of Versailles is too far away for them. So I think it's more today, it's more a mean of keeping the link with the Palace of Versailles in waiting for the time they can come back. More than a total replacement.
Okay, and do you have some maybe statistics how much time they are for how long they are staying even for on your online exhibitions? Have you got some statistics?
Yes, the figures is like that the engagement when you are in virtual or in real life is not the same. I mean, when you are coming to Versailles, unless you're living in Versailles and even though. You're staying there like most of the time, at least for half a day, and most of the time for the full day. And obviously on a digital tour, you're more there for like less than an hour. In Italy, it's more about like 15 to 30 minutes, the average time. But we do see some visitors online that spend 1 hour, more than 1 hour, because they want to explore all the details that the digital tours offer. And this is true that either the VR, Versailles VR experience with Google, or the Versailles Revival virtual tour of the exhibition, if you want to see everything in detail, read everything, it takes time, and you can really have this time. And it's much easier to look at this at home, easier than when you are in the museum, obviously. Sad to say that, but sometimes you have better condition online.
Okay, thank you very much, Paul. And also the question to Soryung, because for 20 years you are gathering actually the public who is interested in technology and art. Who are actually, can you tell us more about who are the public who is interested in this kind of experiences?
So say that again, please. Your last sentence, I'm sorry.
Yeah, so Jung, for 20 years, Art Center Nabi is welcoming the public who is really interested in technology and creation. So can you tell us a few about who is your public? Can you give us some more details about?
Well, yes, my public was mostly 20s and 30s, sometimes 40s, young people. And completely different from probably what most museums and art centers, contemporary art centers are facing. Because I look back my 20 years at Art Center Nabi, and for the first 10 years, because we are young, my staffs were young, we're not we are not really experienced, so we did what we liked. We did something this looks fun, and then we did, and that those events were very popular. And then the second half of 20 years, last 10 years, we thought a lot. And we thought it is our mission, part of our mission, to be critical about the contemporary technological, technoculture and all. And then we made exhibitions, art events, and we were not very well received. So what I'm saying is we are looking at a completely different kind of audience, millennials, and maybe generations, MZ, and who are very keen on the idea of play, and they don't want to be told to how to think and how to feel. And, you know, so that's what I can tell you about a new, different kind of audience that we're facing.
Thank you very much, Sohyung. We are almost finishing this panel. We can really talk and talk because there are so many new things that we can talk about, new ways of dissemination of exhibitions, how to create the emotional connection. So maybe before going for 5 minutes of questions from the public, can you just give us like one or two tips on how to create immersive, engaging exhibitions? I will maybe start from next to me, from Valentino. So how to tips, one or two tips, how to create immersive, engaging exhibition. Valentino, do you want to start? Okay, if not, So I ask question to maybe to Roy, because Valentino, I'm not sure if he's here.
If I need to give one tip,
yeah, one or two tips how to create immersive, engaging exhibition.
One tip will be...
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, maybe Valentino, let in this case, I let Roy to reply first.
My mic didn't work.
It's okay. So I come back to Roy, yeah?
One tip is the music. Very, very important in order to create immersion.
Excellent. Okay, so the sound and the role of music in the exhibition. Fantastic. Valentino?
I agree with the sound that is very important, but also the content. You know, it seems easy and stupid to say, but actually too often, you know, virtual reality is based only on the effect, on the shock, you know, instead, you know, creating, you know, that more deeper, you know, content and researching around it.
Okay, thank you, Valentino. So, Jung, one tip,
okay, perfectionist, because I've seen enough bad immersive contents. So you have to be perfect in art, in artistic sensibilities, and also technologically. Perfection.
Thank you very much. So perfection. And Paul, the tip to create an immersive, engaging exhibition.
Yeah, thank you. It's hard to speak after all those good propositions. I would say to join the virtual exhibition with social media engagement, and promote the tools on social media, and ask visitors to share their thoughts on Twitter, Instagram, or on the likes.
Okay, thank you very much. So we have 5 minutes of question. I noted some question already. So the first question, maybe I will ask to everybody. It's from Céline Aspart, I think. Elise Aspart, I'm sorry. It was, have you got your experiences, are collective experiences on or individual one? It was more to Roei, I think, this question.
Yeah, actually both. Collective is very, very important, and this is why physical on-site exhibition proposal are so important, and we are continuing to do so, and hoping that we'll be able to open those space for collective experience. However, what we saw, that we knew it beforehand, and of course the pandemic situation just increased it, that people from their home doing an experience, a self-experience, which also very worthwhile. Important remark that even from home, even when visitors are using one interface, sometimes they are using it collectively with their family member, which is also a very interesting and developing way to share the experience.
Very interesting. Thank you very much. There was also a question to from Victoire Chedry. It was a question to Sir Jung. Do you think the virtual places will be a great next movement?
Yes, I think it could. It cannot replace all the exhibition sites, and maybe in some cases it may be an inferior one to the real spaces, but nevertheless it's an open space, a creative space, and it has a lot of potentials. Do you want me to say why?
Yeah, of course.
Okay. Well, for one thing, as I mentioned, the idea of ownership is very important in nurturing and fostering the art and artists and all the art scenes. The idea that you can make money while making these digital contents or art is a great promise. To a lot of people, a lot of young people, of course. They won't all become millionaires and like people, but still you can get some money, some compensation out of your work. And also because of pandemic, people sort of tasted this this new space and new experiences, and because, well, we were forced to taste it, we were forced to experience it, but nevertheless this helped us to move beyond the physical and the real spaces and opened our eyes to the new possibilities.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you, Sir Jung. Maybe I will take the last question. So, Alice, I saw your question, but maybe I will take the last from Tiffany Attali. Is there the intention for the cultural institution to get in their in-house team some specialists about creating virtual experiences? Maybe question to Roy, to Paul, Valentino.
Yeah, Roy, you want to answer?
Specialist. The question is, what type of specialist? Of course, we need to have new type of abilities, new type of professionalism in this type of technology. However, we will focus on having what we already have, what we call project managers and producers, the actual developers, the actual artists, the actual people who will code will continue to work as we worked before by outsourcing, because we think it's much better from technological and economical wise perspective.
Thank you very much, Paul. So Valentino, yeah. Do you want to add something?
Yeah, just as Roy said, we do have a project manager in our teams, but all the technical part is still made by providers. As a public institution, it's complicated to have in-house the technical side for like various reasons. But we have manager who are running those projects, definitely.
Yes, I agree. For sure. I mean, that will come naturally, not to include other expertise, but probably 80% gonna be external to the institution rather than internal.
Okay, so thank you very much. I saw more questions, but we unfortunately already a little bit go far out of the timing. So I propose you to applaud all of our great speakers. So FN F4, thank you so much. Thank you so much for participating. Thank you for everybody. Thank you. So Elhem will tell you what is the next part of the day. And thank you so much once again.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you again for this amazing talks. That was very enriching and very inspiring. Thank you. So the next in our program. Online performance. An online performance, as you may know, we are partners with the Making Lemonade, an event in Korea that is happening at the same time as Recto VRso. So this great program is in connection with the French Embassy in Korea, the Goethe Institute, the Nabi Center. And they are organizing a symposium through Zoom and YouTube Live around reflections on the future of digital art. Today we'll be broadcasting an online performance from YouTube Live and with Ayun Kwon. Didn't want to misspell the name. Thank you. Can we launch the YouTube Live, please?
It's a tool, so they want to create really ambitious projects. But on the other end, there are less funds.